Mr. Reiner, thank you so much for letting us pay tribute to you and letting us show six of some of your favorite films and ours as well. I hope you heard us laughing for the last 90-some minutes over there in LA, because we were nonstop laughing here with Dead Man Don't Wear Plaid. So thank you.
You have to watch. You people watch my favorite work I've ever done in my life. When I feel the pictures, I'll put this on and smile for the rest of the day.
Mr. Reiner, we've collected some questions from the audience. I'm Bruni Burres, the curator of the festival. And a question that keeps coming up with all of us, the audience, as well as with me, is if you can talk about the origins of this project with you and Steve Martin and George Guy, and how it came to be. Because as I was doing some research, I found out it started as a project called Depression, and it's changed very much in production. So if you could talk about that, that would be great.
Well, what happened is I was talking to Steve about doing another film, and the idea of using an old clip, talking to an old clip came up. It sounded like a good idea, and that was what to do. Now, Steve started working on a film that he was going to take 6 months to finish. What the name of it? I'll remember. I think Cyrano directed it. Anyway, and so I sent this guy, George Guy, to Cyprus. And what about using one clip? But use only clips. Steve Martin played a man who spoke to the people. Of course, the Agnes was always a dark-haired man. We dyed Steve's hair black. So when he juxtaposed and spoke to these people already gone from the earth, it looked like he was actually talking to the actual original actor.
And this, no, continue.
I just remembered one thing that how he got this. He had a greatness about him. You know, he started to choke. He started to choke that a woman. The able to go out.
Was Bette Davis.
Oh, the one who was choking. And he started to choke an actress about Wolf and Renee. And how it got to be that every time he heard the word cleaning woman, dessert, his father ran away with cleaning woman. And in telling the story, he used the woman he saw when he used the word cleaning woman, and the sugar. The ward, yes. In the middle of it all, he realized he was choking the train. And he stopped and said, excuse me, I didn't mean to do that. He almost put her life up. And from then on, we realized what he had seen, the recreation of this, somebody saying, cleaning woman, and he has another movie. Ed Davis said he's in another room. She said, I'll make you some sandwiches. He says, I have some for sale ready. The cleaning woman, and he goes, cleaning woman. And we actually have to see from a movie where he is choking the life out of Ed Davis. And he realizes he's doing this horrible thing.
And can you talk about the origins of the story, and did the story of the cheesemaker scientist and the daughter and Reardon come first, or did you pick your favorite clips from your favorite films? And
first, we had to have a reason for it, and we had the father of the girl who Rachel Ward's father, who was a cheesemaker, and Geez, smelled so bad that they wanted to get him out of the middle of the town. So, you know, it wouldn't stink up the town. And that was the premise of all, which was too stupid. Anyway, but the point being, that once we decided that we'd be talking to people who were already gone, Rigby, and his name Rigby, we didn't know how he got that name. And one of the old clips was Charles Lawton saying to a character, "So, Rigby," or now we know his name is Rigby. And then it says, "And here's a $15,000 check, Rigby Reardon." But Petey, oh, his name is Rigby Reardon. So that became his name. And we made sure we used it with our actors or, living actors in the film.
And I read that Steve Martin didn't watch any film noir before making this film with you and Rachel Ward and the team. Is that, did any of you watch any old of your favorite classics before making the film?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't understand.
Steve didn't see any noir. He was not a noir fan yet, as of yet.
Well, Steve, I don't know if he was a noir fan or not, but he was busy looking at other pictures. And during that time, we were collecting clips. We looked at one, that was the first one I've ever had, looking at old films, black films. And there was a line or a snippet that might be someday to build a story. And we had on the wall maybe 200 single lines that were said to one character to another. And we tried to incorporate those in the story. Luckily, we found the story that worked. I love one thing about it. See, he came up with the title, "Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid." He said very quietly. And he added the very epic, because I didn't know what that meant. And then at the end, he called the Island, and he said, "Dead men don't wear plaid." I still don't know what that means.
It's a fantastic title. And can you also talk about where your character came from?
That's funny thing. We had a character of a Von Kluck, a head Nazi. And during the course of the movie, Rigby Reardon comes to somebody's house to talk to somebody about this subject he's concerned about. And the butler is at the door. Rigby is faint. He feels faint at the door. And at the door, he says to the tuxedo butler, "I feel dizzy. Catch me." He says, "I'm not a butler, I'm not a catcher." He lets him fall to the floor. And that's how this character. Then we realized, he's hanging out as a butler, hiding his true identity because he's wanted as a killer, as an old Nazi.
Of course. Aren't all old butlers wanted to as old Nazis?
Oh my God. I love General Wilhelm von Kluck.
We all love it, thank you.
Even von Kluck was funny. Von Kluck.
How did you and Steve Martin do that scene without laughing through the entire scene?
That was one of the hard things to keep a straight face, but professionals do that. And then we laugh when we say cut, we laugh. And hard, too.
And can you speak a little bit about the technical aspects? Because you made this film before blue screen and many of the devices we have today. Your Michael Chapman, the cinematographer, who's brilliant, the editor, you as the director, to really edit everything so perfectly. So we do think Steve Martin's talking to all of those people.
This movie was made in the editor's room, but all of my editor. We laid out all these pieces and it felt like a jigsaw puzzle. As a matter of fact, I said it's the most fun I ever had. And after we have this little tete-a-tete, you and I, I'm actually going to put the film on and watch it then. Remember and smile over the moments that I enjoyed Rachel Ward and there were little things in it that, as a very fact, you're getting that $10 as an upper for his work is effective.
But what about the production design? What did John, had it
John the Cure, who conducted this, one of the great production designers ever, he created some of the sets. And when we put together half of the set, we had created our head to match the ones in the film. And had a fight was whether the back part of Universal and hair was original set. And couldn't believe it. It's the set where Perry went to train with Steve Martin, really, that's the actual train. The part of where we set for the train with Susan.
And I believe you had Edith Head, one of the greatest costume designers of all time, who actually had done the costumes for Suspicion for some of the films that you use clips from. And she was also the costume designer for your film, Dead Man Don't Wear Plaid, for Steve Martin's costumes, for Rachel Ward. Can you talk about how you worked together with her?
Rachel Ward, by the way, we had it. The greatest costume designer that ever lived, Edith Head. And she was old then. She came up with original things that were used in other pictures. And she's very careful with this copy of this hat, this beautiful hat. And very large, rim hat. And Ian Murphy said to this doll, but he's very open and critical. And he had a presentation. Slept there and the past table with them was finished. So we dedicated them to our readers. She had a building, but we had built. Is that bigger, more in Hollywood's whole thing?
Some other questions from the audience. One person would like to know, when did you realize you were funny, and were your parents funny?
What happens, you are either born with a funny bone, two things, environment and genes. I was born in a house where people loved, my mother and father loved comedy. They loved to go see Charlie Chaplin, Buster Keaton, and then the Marx Brothers. So we're always going to comedies. And I had a passion for retelling those, some of the stories I heard on radio. And I retold them and embellished them. I did have a sense of humor, but I did have the genes of my parents who really loved comedy.
And here's a comment. We think you're absolutely brilliant, an American conic icon. What are you working on now?
What am I working on now? What should we tell them?
Well, I must have film books.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, there are four or five books that are just coming out. These two, this one's 2 years ago. It's called The Wife, a 95 recording, Movies I Love. And this is, look at this.
Nice photo.
This is it's a volume film set that Carl did.
Wow. Wow.
And Purpose Review just gave a 5-star review of both volumes.
Wow.
So if you're film nerds.
We are all film nerds. We're all film nerds. Okay. What should we do now?
This is a coffee table size book, and he put the posters in and little scenes that he loves. And these are all the movies that he loves.
It's a compendium of every movie I ever saw since my kid. And it is now ensconced in the Library of Congress. I'm so excited about that. To claim that it has. But I've also done a couple other books I absolutely adore. One is the history of radio, starting when I was 4 or 5 years old listening to the radio. My father building a crystal set, and we're listening to static. And the history of radio, listening to all these radio stations with pictures of the actors and a couple of the scenes from the radio program. And that, what is it? No, I'm forgetting how that I listen.
Well,
there's one I give away. It's a book called How to Live Forever. And it was written by a Pakistani aunt. His name was H-U-M-O-H-A-D. How to Live Forever, but someone who has. And it's 271 pages. And the opening line is, when you get up in the morning, you start a project, work on the project. When you're satisfied that the improvements you've made on the project, start a new project. That's the only line in the book, and it goes 271 pages. And the thing is, and it's a joke, I give that book away for free. It looks like a real book. The testimonials in the back, all fake people, Mel Brooks, people all X, you know, all the and they all say the same thing. I couldn't put this book down. I put it down. It's an old big mind think alike. It's funny people said that. But the thing is, it's absolutely true. If you wake up in the morning, it is how to live forever. Look at these
reviews. Oh my God. Wow, so many reviews.
So let's get endorsements. A real page turner. I can put that on Mel Brooks, X. Billy Crystal, C-R-Y, C-L. Steinfeld. Jerry Lewis, R-R-I-E-L-U-I-S, Steve Martin, Albert Brooks, B-R-O-X, Dyke Van Dyke, Gal with an I-E, and Carol Burnett. Carol Burnett. The above proves you all great minds think alike. And there it is with the which, by the way, I have a book on Trump called The Falling of Trump, and in it I have Mount Rushmore, all with he got bored. These people don't go there anymore because they're bored looking at Washington, you know, Lincoln, Roosevelt, so he put up his own statues, carvings, four different angles of.
Mr. Reiner, did you send out a tweet today?
I didn't tweet today, but what's the guy in Open House? Keep forgetting his name.
Yeah, me too. Don't we all?
Son Trump, I think Trump, yes. In case it is leaving, I think.
Oh.
Maybe. He's going to say, someday he's going to do this, and he's going to mean it. Every day he does something that, you know, is interesting, because the New York Times about 2 months ago had a thing where he went and bought property in Connecticut and didn't pay taxes on any of these pieces of property. And the only state and town in the country that it's a law, you don't pay taxes on things you bought, you're appoint jail. There's a lot of reasons they go to jail after he's out of office, either doesn't make it in any event, but he won't go to jail.
Definitely.
Where he belongs. Yeah. A better place than when he's in jail.
I think everybody here agrees with you, and maybe all on the East Coast. Do you have a favorite comedy of comedies?
A favorite comedy? Oh, yeah, there are. Well, in the history of comedies, I always remembered Big Deal on Madonna Street, an Italian comedy, which from beginning to end, I think it's one of the best comedies ever made. And of course, I can also say any one of
Mel Brooks's real iconic ones, you know, the Blazing Saddles. But there are few and far between. Of course, the beginning of it all would have happened without a guy named Charlie Chaplin. He was brilliant. And all the other. Buster Keaton may have been one of the greatest of all time. And they said, what was his name? Safety Lad. No, not Safety Lad. The guy.
Oh, was, Harold.
Huh?
Harold.
Harold.
Yeah.
Harold Lloyd doesn't get his just due. He was a brilliant filmmaker, comic filmmaker.
Okay. So we have two more questions. They concern the 2,000-year-old man. We want to know if there's going to be an update on that.
Well, I think we did three or four of them. But never forget how it came to pass. I just started to work for the Show of Shows, and Sid Caesar had a friend who used to sell him jokes. It was Mel Brooks. I walked into the office not knowing who this guy was, and he was doing a Jewish play. And I remember the first words out of his mouth. He says, you know how hard it is to set sail these days? How much it costs to sail? Well, $1.37 a yard. I can't afford to pillage and rape anymore. Those are the lines I heard. I walked into the office. I had just seen the Sunday news programs. I walked into the office, and without telling them, I said, I named him a 2,000-year-old. I is a 2,000-year-old man who actually knew Jesus. Is that true, sir? He didn't know that was coming. Oh, yeah. Very well. He's a thin lad. You're talking about a rows of candles. Both the fell out of guys. They always came into the store. They had a little candy store. I never bought anything. They're nice boys. That was a good line. From then, for the next 5 years, I questioned them at parties. Anytime there was a lull anyplace, I get up and question Mel as a 2,000-year-old. And we figured that was material only for Jews and not anti-Semitic Gentiles. 5 years later, Steve Allen who said, fellas, you got to put on record. We told him, no, it's not really. He's just, over 400 people, sat them down. From that came the 2,000-year-old man. And we even didn't know then it was going to be a hit. I had to go to Universal, and my neighbor was Cary Grant. He came by one day. I said, I got the record for you. He came back the following day. Can only have a dozen. I'm going to London. Are you taking me to London? He said, sure, they speak English there, you know. He came back and he said, she loved it. And I said, who loved it? It'd be mother. She played this in Buckingham Palace. And then I said, fellas, I tell Mel, I said, I think we're in. The biggest shikster of them all. You worry.
How do you talk and not laugh yourself? We're all laughing. We can't stop laughing.
I love it.
What else do you want us to know about Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid? About
what was the question?
Oh, what else do you remember that you would like us to take away to remember about Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid, to think about?
Well, you know that it was, first of all, it was a labor of love. We were doing it from the seat of our pants, you know, driving without a roadmap. And it turned out a beginning, a middle, and an end even, you know, in one book.
Yeah. What about the pajamas?
Oh, yeah. So funny. There was one scene where we had, he replaced a lot of people, and we had to get him looking like a person. So Vincent Price was at Fed working the sharpness, and we had to get him into the sharpness. We put pajamas on him and said, so that they won't recognize us as him. And at the end, Shannon Tony was the fellow who was his, like his helper, and he slipped his pajamas. And the whole last one was all running. He had them, don't worry about your pajamas. Oh, you clean your pajamas, I get your pajamas. Well, everybody, you are. And at the very end, he's still yelling about the pajamas. That's how organic it was. That wasn't
When did you both, did you and Steve Martin know that there would be the Nazi theme in the film? Did you know that always, or was that?
Very important to have a Nazi theme in the show. You have to get back at, continue to get back at Nazis and remind people there was a thing called Hitler and Germany, and they did, 65 million people suffered and died because of this maniac. You can't joke about that, but not joke about it. That's why the Jews are still alive. We find things that would kill other people.
I think everybody agrees with that. We have to keep laughing no matter what. Were there any clips from some of your, from a favorite film that did not get into Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid? Did not fit?
No. We got everything in there we wanted to do. And it was very interesting because this had nothing to do with anything, but there was a guy named Ronald Reagan, you remember him?
Vaguely, yes.
Well, when I was first, I got the Screen Actors Guild, I'd done my first movie, I went to a meeting at Tony Curtis's house where he was, Ronald Reagan was the president of the Screen Actors Guild, and in it we're trying to figure out how to set, when to cut off on residuals. And residuals really helps all the actors who don't work and hurt get some residuals from work in it. And so we're all trying to push it, the cut off date back to as far as we can, because the old actors need impeccable. And he pushed it so that friends, one of the big places, the Universal and 20 movie Borax, got the money, have to give away. And he pushed it in 1967, and that was the cutoff date. And I remember getting when we did the Edmund Fleck, a letter from Weisbauer, who had, we had a bit out of him, it wasn't in it anymore, and he said that I can't pay my rent, but for you, we needed $2,000-$3,000. We sent them the money, and the interesting thing is, actor who needed the money, and when we did that one, no plaid, we had to pay for each 10 seconds. What was $10,000? So the rich get richer and the poor got nothing. So I was on ever since then. And that was one of the reasons.
We can understand. Someone else has asked, do you have a favorite scene in Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid that for you is?
It would have to be the scene with me at the end. It's funny, isn't it? There's a very funny thing in it where Rachel Ward is telling the derivation of how this all came to be, how we call this, the crooks and the, and I'm saying, babe, it is inherent upon the person who came up with that. And we're arguing, so we're all trying to tell the story of the scene, which is very funny. And they listen to her story kindly, my story, they look like this. Anyway, that's one of my favorites.
I think it was all of ours too. And was that Scar just for the movie, or was, you know? No, no, the one in the in Verklund.
I think a little sis taken away.
No, in the film. In the film.
The Scar. So,
yes.
Scar. Well, I thought you meant this band-aid. I had the scar put in. They put some color and something to squeeze it together. I love that scar.
It's brilliant. It's brilliant. And on the big screen, it almost takes up the whole screen, that scar.
Yeah.
We loved it. We loved it.
I love the very fact at the very end, we know he goes crazy when he hears the word cleaning woman. And Rachel Ward is asking me, Van Kloof, and what will I, oh, she's going to make, well, she's going with it, make believe, and what will I be in your thing? You would be my Reiner Macher. What does that mean? She says, what does Reiner Macher mean? It means cleaning. He's wearing pants. Braces, handcuffs, choke. And in the very end, he was about to dismantle the whole of America with a cheese bowl in it. And he goes to spit and saves. He's at least he got Terre Haute.
Yeah, why'd you pick on Terre Haute?
I don't know. Terre Haute sounds funny.
Yeah.
Or Terre Haute.
I want to see if there's any more last minute questions from our audience that haven't already been collected. Mr. Reiner, we want to thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure. Like, we cannot tell you, we made the whole festival.
I play this often, but there's another movie I play that my son did, The Princess Bride.
Yeah. We all love that too. All right, thank you so much, and we'll see you next Sunday, the 14th, after we watch The Man with Two Brains. I seem to be missing my brain tonight.
Two Brains is my other thing. There's one line in Man with Two Brains where he's discussing what it is to keep a brain alive. He's at a big function in a big auditorium, and the he makes a point, and the audience starts to murmur. And Steve said, what are they saying? Oh, they're just saying, what are they murmuring? Oh, they're just saying, murmur, murmur, murmur.
Thank you. I just will leave with the murmur, murmur, murmur. Thank you so, so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a wonderful rest of your day. Until next Sunday. Thank you.